yet, Jay. Listen, I just want to, guys, can we have a little chat with Jamie a little bit about his career, because he's had such a career and I want to hear it from the horse's mouth itself. Obviously, been in the industry and knowing you personally, you kind of hear a lot of things. Yeah. And I just thought, let's get you in. Let's have a chat with you. Let's hear it from your own mouth, you know, because tell us about your upbringing growing up as a kid in South London.
Well, we had tough upbringing growing up in South London, in Battersea, really. Jamaican parentage.
Yeah.
At the age of 17, my mum and dad, they was a bit older, wanted to go back to Jamaica. They retired, packed up, went back, wanted me to come, but I always wanted to play football.
Yeah.
So I stayed in England with my sister, who was 4 years older than me. Right. Never had much money. And then I was left on the streets of London, where I started getting involved in certain crimes, which I'm not proud of, but you have to do it to survive. But I never had no choice at the time. Like, I was trying to work as well. I was working as a mechanic. I was getting £50 a week. I got paid on a Friday. It was finished on a Friday. So what am I going to do for the rest of the week? So I went out and done certain things, got caught, and then I ended up getting 3 years.
You're doing a little bit of naughtiness out on the streets. Yeah. So you get nicked now. You go to prison. Tell us a little bit about that side of it. A young man going into prison. What was that like? And that part of your life?
Well, the first time I went to prison, obviously you're scared when you walked into prison and that. Mm-hmm. Anyone who tells you that they wasn't scared when they walked into prison is lying.
Right.
So I walked through the prison, but next day I woke up and that, half my friends were in there, so like,
done your time there. You've come out.
Got parole first time.
So obviously you was being a good boy. You put on weight. You know, you was living clean, doing the right things, keeping your nose clean.
Yeah.
And you come out and trouble follows you again.
Yep. You know what happens? When you come from a certain area and you're into certain things, if you go back to that area, it will always catch up on you.
Mm. Even if you want it or you don't want it because of what
you've done things in the past and that.
And it just catches up with you.
It won't go away.
Right.
All right. So I've come out and we've seen the boy and something happened and that. And then obviously he's went to the police and that. I've got arrested again.
After being out for 3 months.
I was on the run for 6 weeks of that 3 months, actually. Right. So, being on the run, you can't work.
No.
You can only do crime. All right? You go to work, you're going to get arrested.
Wow.
So you can only do crime to survive. And in the end, it gets tiring at the end of the day.
But you're doing crime to survive. You just come out there, Nick.
Yeah.
But it's almost like your hands are tired because you have to do that. Because
you must be looking over your shoulder every morning.
Always looking over your shoulder, like where my sister lived as well. I wouldn't go back to the house because I knew the police would be turning up there. I'd be staying at mates' houses here, there and everywhere. And in the end, I saw the police. I could have run. I just said, you know what, I've had enough of this.
You were tired?
Yeah, I was tired.
Was it almost a relief? And that sounds silly, but to be
it was a relief and that. But when you go into a police station, you don't know how much bird you're going to get. You know you're going to get a bird because I was in breach of my parole as well.
Okay.
So I knew that I was going to get a sentence.
That was going to come back as well, yeah.
I knew that was going to come back as well. So I was on remand. I went to Wormwood Scrubs first. Then I went to Brixton. And I was on trial at Brixton at Kingston Crown Court, and then I got found guilty because my friend went Queen evidence against me, and I ended up getting 4 years.
In the nick again?
I'm in the nick again.
Which one this time?
I was in, I'd done Wormwood Scrubs, done Brixton, and then I ended up in Camp Hill. When I got sentenced, I ended up in Camp Hill on the Isle of Wight.
Is that the way you was, Rob?
I was camping on the Isle of Wight.
So you was camping on the Isle of Wight. Sorry, Jay.
So for my sentence, which was 4 years, it was the most violent prison for that sentence. I ended up there.
So why did it have the reputation, or why was it so violent there?
Because all the troubled prisoners from London and whatever, they used to send them on the island. If you misbehave in Camp Hill, then there's Parkhurst and Albany. And then they send you to there where people are doing double figure numbers. You don't really want to be going in there.
So you're going to be there with people that's got nothing to lose.
Nothing to lose. Like, I went in there when I had the fight in Camp Hill.
And this time, how old are you now?
Just turned 21.
Wow.
There's a little boy, there's all big grown villains.
So
in
probably
there.
There's not all your mates now in this.
None of my mates.
So it's just totally
none of my mates in there. Man.
So now you're really starting to feel alone.
I felt alone.
So you've gone through this awful time. The only way I can describe it is awful time. I wouldn't, you know, and I know the effect it's had on you as a person and the mental toughness that you've now later on gained from that.
Yeah.
So you're in jail.
Yeah.
You're going through this horrible experience. Where at which point in your life do you decide that, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore. I've got a God-given talent to play football. At which part, when you was in that place, did you realise that, you know what, I'm going to have a little go and play football? How did that come about? Because, you know, you listen to most kids' stories like, you know, oh yeah, I was playing football for my Sunday teams and I got picked by Arsenal, Tottenham, Liverpool. That's the normal route, right? And you would agree. So you didn't go through the normal route. That's why I think your story is so amazing. So how did that all happen? The football side of it.
The football side.
While you was in there.
Yeah, when I first got there, I'd only done like 9-10 months and that. And you used to have an inter-wing competition like every Christmas and like summertime, like June.
Inter-wing competition?
Inter-wing competition.
What does that mean?
There's all different wings in the prison. So you used to have a competition.
What wing did you play?
I played right wing.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That was the really hard wing as well.
That's where the harder criminals. Yeah.
Like the first Christmas I got there and that, we had a wing competition and we ended up winning the competition. Right, for the first time for ages.
Oh.
And then they had a prison team.
So when you played football, did you find that people gave you more respect because you was a good footballer? Did that happen in there?
But it never stopped them from trying to kick me up in the air and that.
So they used that time?
I was always getting kicked up in the air, but I would never, ever retaliate on the football pitch. Just get up, dust myself off and go again.
So you had a different mindset when you was on the football pitch?
On the football pitch, I always had a different mindset. I would never retaliate because as soon as you retaliate, they know they're getting at you. Right, you get the ball again and go past them, then they're in for a hard time.
Yeah, sure.
Right, and that's what I carried through to when I played professional football.
Right, so you had this competition.
We won the competition.
You won it first time.
Then
in
they
years.
Picked me for the prison team, which was on Boxing Day. We played against a team called Cow Sports.
Yeah.
Right, and it's funny. It's like one of them films. Like they let all the prisoners out to watch the game.
Yeah,
the things what they're shouting on the sideline and they shout that.
I told you it's like a film, innit?
Escape to victory, innit? I'm just digging out.
I'm probably gonna go football like Billy Jones, but I'm escape
to victory. Football is an awesome
Yeah, Pele, man.
Stallone.
Yeah.
It's intimidating atmosphere as well. By the way, yeah, the prisoners. You look at them; they just look like criminals, and that. You know what I mean?
They just look intimidating.
Yeah, look. It was intimidating. But I played against Cal Sports. We beat them 3-2. I scored 2 goals. A last minute header to win it and that. And then I'd only done a year at the time. They went to my governor and my PO, prison officer and that, who works in the gym. And they asked him
if this is Cal Sports?
Yeah, they went
to the team you played against?
Yeah.
Right?
He was mates with one of the prison officers and that. Wow. And he went to him and said, I like that Jamie Lawrence. Can he come out and play for us?
That is some bottle.
But I'd only done a year out of a 4-year sentence. So you have to go up parole after a year and 4 months.
Right. So you're 4 months shy.
Yeah, I had 4 months shy. So after I'd done the 4 months and I got knocked back from my parole, I went on home leave. I came back and they allowed me to start going out and playing for Cal Sports. Right. Wow. I loved it.
Where did you go from Cal to...
After I got released after doing 2 years, 2 months.
And you continued to play for Cal then?
Yeah, I had all TV cameras and newspapers coming into the prison while I was in there, coming interviewing me and that. And then I ended up, you remember Ambrose Mendy?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Ambrose Mendy was in the prison when I was in there. And he wanted to...
Was he?
Yeah.
Ambrose Mendy?
What was he doing?
He was doing 2 years for fraud, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so he was an agent at the time. So he's gone to me, I'll get you a team when you come out, son. All right, so I got released and that. And then I went to Millwall, but Mick McCarthy offered me like £200 a week, but he wanted me to stay with the kids.
Right.
And for me, like, if you want me to sign for your club, you've got to trust me.
Yeah.
Right. I don't want you to keep an eye on me and all that. Just trust me. And then I ended up going to Sunderland. Which ended up to be the
best. Was that still through Ambrose?
Nah. Barry Siltman.
Oh, Silky. Hey,
no, Silky. Very Silky.
What a guy.
Silky got me to...
Who was manager then? Who was manager at Sunderland?
Terry Butcher. I remember going up there. I had a week's
trial. So Barry Sutman calls you and said, listen, kid, we got a trial for you.
At Sunderland. Ian Atkins, do you remember him?
Yeah.
He picked me up at the train station, took me to a hotel. The only hotel I stayed in was a prison before.
Right. And you couldn't leave when you wanted to.
Yeah. So I got in there, like, got into this hotel. I'm like, I'm fucking buzzing to tell you the truth.
This is a space of how many months?
3 months.
3 months since you've been released from.
3 months of being
released. So what year has this been? It's been.
This was 1993.
93?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was at Newcastle in 92.
Yeah.
So
yeah, moved there.
I would have been up there, yeah.
Yeah, 93. I remember seeing Coley out when I signed at Sunderland and that.
Yeah,
he's a good pal of mine.
Coley.
Yeah, good lad. So like, I gone out there on trial, went out there on a Sunday, trained Monday, Tuesday. I was homesick at this time. I wanted to come back to London. I couldn't understand what the fuck they were saying. Now,
anyway. Yeah, translators back then.
I never had a clue what they were saying. So we had a game against Leeds on the Thursday. Played against Leeds on the Thursday. I ripped the left back, a new arsehole, Kevin Sharp at the time.
Oh,
and
nice.
You know when you played well. Yeah, you know when you had a good game. But you don't know if they're going to sign you or not. Mm. So next morning, Terry Butcher's brought me in the office. He's gone, you excite me, kid. Yeah. I'm going to sign you.
You've had this amazing transformation in your luck in terms of... Yeah. Now you're playing the Premier League, signed by...
That was Championship.
Old money back then. And, you know, Terry Butcher signed you. You're making debuts.
Yeah.
Then the worst thing happens. Terry gets sacked.
He gets sacked. And then Doncaster signed me under Ian Atkins.
Yes.
He left from Sunderland and went to Doncaster.
So when you left there, what was your emotion? Like, what was your feeling? Like, you just didn't get on with the gaffer?
I never got on with the gaffer. I hated it there under him. And when Ian Atkins come in for me, I jumped at the chance and he paid money for me. I was like, £20,000.
Wow.
Well, I mean, I'm in prison, then people are buying me for 20 grand.
Yeah.
So then I went there and then he got sacked after 2 months.
So someone said you're a lucky child. Yeah. So he gets sacked.
And I thought, I was in London and I had a call from Barry Siltman. He's gone, we've got to move. Shut up, Silk.
Yeah.
Gone, we've got to move. Leicester want you. So drove up to Leicester.
The manager at the time was Martin O'Neill?
No, Mark McGee.
Mark McGee?
Mark McGee was the manager. And drove up. Colin Lee was there as well.
Right.
Drove up to the hotel. Next day, done a medical, proper medical. Not that one where they knock your knees and the reflexes and all that.
I love those medicals. I've passed loads of those.
So you had such a long and fantastic career.
So drove up there. And then I signed the next day. It ended up being for £300,000.
Wow.
Yeah, I was like,
wow.
Okay, no.
Could you even comprehend that?
I couldn't comprehend that at the time. Right.
What did that mean to you when they said, you know, this is your transfer fee at that time, coming from where you've come from?
I still can't believe it to this day, right? For me,
and you was buzzing about 20,000.
I was buzzing about £20,000, but now I've signed in the Premiership.
Yeah,
even though we were struggling at the time, but I'm playing with proper players now. I'm playing against proper players,
earning proper money.
Well, it's all right, but I could spend it as just learn. Yeah. You know?
So it was going exactly the same way.
You don't put nothing in place. Yeah, you don't never put nothing in place.
So you're making all this money. You're going to Leicester.
Yeah. And then go to Leicester. Worst thing ever happens. I have 2 kids in the space of 4 months.
Wait a minute. Even Rob Lee can do that.
We're all looking confused doing the maths now.
Wait a minute.
It might be 2 different girls, James.
Yes, mate. I had 2 birds pregnant at the same time and that. So, absolute nightmare.
So, you was the kind of shy and retiring type?
Yeah, I was, mate.
Yeah. Oh my God, so how did you cope with that?
That was stressful, to say the least, mate.
That was proper stress.
Yeah, but I've got 2 beautiful kids out of it.
But
that's
did the two mums know about each other?
I had to tell them.
Oh.
I had to tell them.
And well, that must have been
murders.
Tough.
Yeah, I had murders. One knew anyway about the other one. So I had to tell the other one and she attacked me.
But honesty being the best policy.
We was training. We was all on the piss the night before. And then we trained the next day. And Gunnar Haller's gone to do something. And he's caught me on the point and my jaw, he broke my jaw on both sides.
Oh, no.
So I was out for 5 weeks. And I just got back just before the Liverpool game, I was at. And he's thrown me in. I found out the week as well that my dad was dying leading up to the game.
Oh, yeah. My goodness.
Yeah. So I went to Paul Jordan and I said to him, right, Gaffer, I don't know if I can play. So do it for your dad. So on the Sunday, go out. And I was like a man possessed and that 1-1 nil. And him being a good man manager as well, coming to the change room and that, he's gone to me, that's for your dad, son.
Yeah, amazing. Then,
yeah.
Amazing, amazing. Yeah. Jay, listen, I could sit here and talk to you all day. Mate. And I know you've also wrote a book as well from... Yeah,
Prison to the Premiership.
Prison to the Premiership, yeah. Which is, you know, by what you just told us, you know, I'm sure a few of the guys are here, we'll go and pick it up.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you.